Hello everyone, hello to all the attendees, hello to everyone watching us on Facebook, hello ladies and gentlemen, this is Govind Kumar Chaturvedi. Yes, am I audible?
Now I think you're audible.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Sir has just joined us.
Hello sir.
Hello, yes, good evening. Yes.
Good evening, my lords.
Good evening, yes.
Lords, my lords. Yes. How are you, sir?
Yes.
It's a pleasure to have you, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I would just like to now introduce the event to everyone, the attendees here, the people watching us on Facebook, everyone here. We know these are right now grim and dark times. We are all dealing it with as a country, as a society, as humanity. And for that, we, Lawyers Club India, Trivikram and Associates and Creators Legal, I have actually worked towards certain initiatives to help people on a pan-India scale. And we are doing a little bit to help out everyone to make sure that we as a society and humanity come out of this. It's been very small, but we're increasing those initiatives and we are helping people, but we want to help more people. But for everyone who's not right now sick, let's please stay at home, listen to keep the distance and not be helpful in spreading the disease. So staying at home is very essential that we also keep our minds stimulated. And that is another initiative we have started, that where we are bringing the most eminent and honorable and the knowledgeable speakers of our country to come and give us these wonderful lectures on very great topics. I would now like to call Mr. Trivikram for introduction of sir and the topic he's going to talk about today. Over to you, Mr. Trivikram.
Thank you so much, Govind. And it's indeed a privilege and an honor to introduce such a stalwart judge, Honorable Mr. Justice Kunha, sir. Right. Sir hails from Gurupur, a small town in Mangalore. Sir graduated from the very famous college, Sri Dharmasthala Manjunatha College of Law. Mrs. Kunha played volleyball during his student days. Sir entered bar in the year 1985 and practiced till 2001. In 2001, sir joined the Karnataka State Judiciary, and sir has served as a district judge. Sir has also served as the Registrar General of the Honorable High Court of Karnataka, and sir was elevated as a judge in the year 2016. Very recently, not even a month back, sir retired from the Karnataka High Court. And it's such a big privilege to have sir with us. And of course, the topic chosen today is equally important and very, very interesting topic. Right? Irrespective of advocate practicing on the trial side or on the appellate side, it is very important. Let me not waste the time. So I think, Govind, you should hand over.
Thank you for the introduction about sir. As much said about sir is less. We all have heard about him and his all story. So I would now, without wasting anyone's time, I would now like to call Honorable Justice Kunhun sir on the topic of reverse burden. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for being here.
So thank you, Mr. Govind and Mr. Trivikram and your team of Lawyers Club India. I'm sure that the efforts, though you say it's a small efforts that you put in arranging these series of lectures, are yielding desired results, as is evident that many young advocates and law graduates are showing keen inclination to learn practical aspects of law applied in our courts. Therefore, while appreciating your initiative, I wish all the best to you and to the participants who log into these series of lectures. Today's topic, reverse burden, is a slight deviation from the general topic we commonly discuss, namely the burden of proof. The general conception is that in a criminal trial, the burden of proof of a charge is always on the prosecution. This conception is based on the underlying principle followed in our criminal jurisprudence that an accused is presumed to be innocent until proved guilty. The fallout of this principle is that there may be overwhelming evidence to show that an accused is the perpetrator of crime. Take for example, a group of miscreants illegally pulled down a standing structure in the broad daylight. There may be hundreds of eyewitnesses who know that it is A, B, and C are the offenders. But the law says that until the charge against them is proved in accordance with law, they are innocent. If this is the position of law, the question that would arise as to who has to prove that the person sent up for trial is guilty or not. It is here again, the law says, whoever desires any court to give judgment against the accused must prove it. This principle, you can see, is engrafted in section 101 to 103 of the Indian Evidence Act. See what the section says, section 101 of the Indian Evidence Act, whoever desires any court to give judgment as to any legal right or liability dependent on the existence of facts which he asserts must prove that those facts exist. The illustration, A desires a court to give a judgment that B shall be punished for a crime which A says B has committed. A must prove that B has committed the crime. So the burden of proof as per the provisions of the Indian Evidence Act is on the person who asserts it or who wants a judgment in his favor. It is essentially the burden lies on him. Section 103, burden of proof as to particular fact, even to prove a particular fact, the law says the burden of proof as to any particular fact lies on that person who wishes the court to believe in its existence, unless it is provided by any law that the proof of that fact shall lie on any other particular person. Example, A prosecutes B for theft and wishes the court to believe that B admitted the theft to C. A must prove the admission. So the law with regard to the burden of proof, you can find in the Indian Evidence Act. But since the crime, as you know, is an offense against the state, naturally, one who asserts it or one who is required to prove is the state, because it is essentially an offense against the state. Therefore, the burden of proof is essentially and primarily rest with the prosecution. This is the first principle we must know before proceeding further. As per the above provision, you can see that since the entire burden to prove the charge is on the prosecution, the accused has nothing to prove. On the other hand, if you see, our law grants him a right to silence. It gives him a privilege of maintaining silence. He need not have to prove anything. You also cannot compel him to be a witness against himself. See, this fundamental right is guaranteed to the accused under Article 20, subclause 3 of the Constitution of India. Therefore, presumption of innocence is now considered a basic human right. Therefore, to hold him guilty, you must essentially prove that he is guilty in accordance with law. The law has cast this primary burden on the prosecution. Therefore, the first thing we have to bear in mind is that the primary burden to prove the guilt of the accused is on the prosecution. So with this as a prelude, you must also remember that under the existing law, even if no burden of proof is cast on the accused, yet if you see the legal provisions or the statutory provisions, the accused could take upon himself to prove certain things. Where do we get this? You just see section 105 of the Indian Evidence Act. Burden of proving that case of accused comes within exceptions. So the heading of the section itself says, the burden of proving that the case of the accused comes within exceptions. When a person is accused of any offense, the burden of proving the existence of circumstances bringing the case within any of the general exceptions in the Indian Penal Code or within any special exception or proviso contained in any other part of the same code or in any law defining the offense is upon him, and the court shall presume the absence of such circumstances. So it is, we generally say that the fundamental principle is that the entire burden in a criminal trial is on the prosecution. But there are provisions. If during a trial, if the accused takes upon, or if the accused sets up a defense, the defense or the general exceptions that are provided under the Indian Penal Code from section 76 to 106, then the burden shifts, or the burden is cast on the accused to prove it, and it shall be presumed, and the court shall presume the absence of such circumstances. So there is equal burden on the accused. For example, in a case of murder, he's charged for a murder. Then if he has to say that, I take shelter under one of the exceptions, that at the time of commission of the offense, I was suffering from unsoundness of mind. Or for example, if he is charged of causing grievous hurt, and he wants to say that, no, the hurt was caused in a moment of sudden provocation. See, all these are defenses which are available either under the general exceptions under in the code itself, or in the offenses that is defined under the code. Then the burden is on the accused to prove these defenses. Therefore, to say that accused has nothing to prove, that may not be wholly correct. Further, if you see section 106, I would say that this section directly casts the burden on the accused to prove the facts as which are especially in his knowledge. So read section 106. Burden of proving fact especially within knowledge. When any fact is especially within the knowledge of any person, the burden of proving the fact is upon him. I think these are the instances we come across very often during trial, especially when the death of a woman takes place within the four corners of the wall. And if the death takes place and there are allegations that immediately preceding the death, the woman was subjected to ill treatment or harassment on account of the demand or non-satisfying of the dowry, it is called as a dowry death. You see section 113B of the Indian Evidence Act. When the question as to whether a person has committed the dowry death of a woman, and it is shown that soon before her death, such woman had been subjected by such person to cruelty or harassment for or in connection with any demand for dowry, the court shall presume that such person had caused the dowry death. Likewise, if you see 114A of the Evidence Act, section 114 capital A, which was introduced by later amendment, presumption as to absence of consent in certain prosecutions for rape. In a prosecution for rape under clauses so and so of section 376, where sexual intercourse by the accused is proved, and the question is whether it was without the consent of the woman alleged to have been raped, and such woman states in her evidence before the court that she did not consent, the court shall presume that she did not consent. So these are the instances where the burden shifts or passes on the accused. So therefore, when we talk about the reverse burden placed on the accused in some of the special act, which we'll be discussing shortly, we must remember that even under the existing law, to certain extent, burden is also cast on the accused, though it is limited to certain facts which are exclusively within the knowledge or with regard to the defense set up by him. I think these aspects we have to keep in mind while trying to understand the concept that we are dealing. So keeping these principles in mind, let us now proceed to discuss the question as to what is reverse burden. I think to understand this concept, I would say that we must have a fair idea of the term, what is an offense and what is proof of an offense. Offense, as we generally know, is made up of certain facts, or what we generally call it, ingredients of an offense. Take, for example, the offense of dacoity. Section 391 of the IPC defines it. It is when five or more persons either commit or attempt to commit robbery, we say it is a dacoity. Now, in order to prove this offense, what are the facts that are required to be proved? That there were five or more persons at the time of the commission of the offense, that they either committed or attempted to commit the offense. At the time of commission of the offense, they were armed with the weapons. They used those weapons to cause hurt to the victims. See, these are the facts which constitute the offense, and these are the facts which are required to be proved in a trial. Evidence is deduced to prove the facts. So evidence in a criminal trial is deduced to prove the facts. So we can't say that evidence is deduced to prove the offense, because the facts, if they are proved, then only the offense gets proved. Therefore, in a murder charge, for example, the offense is made up of the certain facts. That is, first fact that has to be proved is that the deceased met with a homicidal death. Second, the accused caused the death either by stabbed or by any other mode, many other method, that he had a motive to cause the death. See, all these are the facts what we say are the constituents making up or making out the offense. And these facts are required to be proved. What are the facts? Of course, again, it is defined under Section 3 of the Act, which may not be necessary for us, for our discussion now. Now, a fact is said to be proved when, after considering all the material placed before the court considers the existence of that fact is probable, or it is likely to exist, if any prudent man comes to a conclusion that considering that evidence that such a fact is likely to exist, then we say a fact is proved. So fact, as you know, is a state of mind, or the fact what a witness sees, or whatever it may be. So when an evidence is adduced in proof of this fact, and the court considers it from the standard of preponderance of probability, that is, what a prudent man under the circumstances of the case would believe it to exist or not to exist, we say a fact is said to be proved. So this is the scheme or the procedure in a court of law to establish an offense. And as we said, that all the necessary the material or the facts establishing the offense, the burden, we said, is on the prosecution. So what is the burden cast on the prosecution? To prove all these facts which ultimately make out or establishes the offense or establishes the charge. But there are certain facts which a prosecution cannot be expected to prove, or rather we can say it is impossible to be proved by the prosecution. Are there such circumstances? Or there can be certain types of cases where the offense is such, the prosecution cannot easily prove these facts. See, I can give you any example. I can give an example. For example, an offense is committed against a child. Now the allegation is that, now consider the example of the teacher has been accused of the charges under the POXO Act. The allegation is that this school teacher was putting his hand in the blouse of the lady students or the girl students. Now he may take up a defense stating that I had called these students for tuition and they used to come and discuss with me. And while discussing with me, there used to be some moments when my hand might have touched their breasts, or the students themselves were trying to understand the issue and they were grouping together, they were falling on me. And at that time, there might have been some physical contact, but I never intended to commit any offense against the children. Now, how to prove this intention? Is it possible for the prosecution to prove? What is the mechanism by which the prosecution, can the victim or can the evidence be adduced from the or through the victim to establish the motive? See, these are the facts which, though under the general law, the burden is on the prosecution to prove each and every fact constituting the offense. But there are circumstances where the certain types of certain facts which cannot be expected from the prosecution, or rather it is impossible for the prosecution to prove it. Whereas the circumstances under which this offense took place is known to the accused. It is easier for the accused to prove it. Rather than, therefore, the law says, now here we have to balance the right. One is the right of the accused to keep silence. Right of the accused to say that unless you prove my guilt to the hilt, I am deemed to be innocent. At the same time, the interest of the society to prove the offenses, especially in this kind of offenses where there is no mechanism, no mode by which you can prove. It is under those circumstances, the law says, the burden to prove there, it is not prudent to say that, to cast the burden only on the prosecution. Rather, in such cases, you shift the burden on the accused. This is a fact which he can prove easily. This is a fact or the circumstances which he knows, under which the circumstance, the offense has been committed. So therefore, allow him to prove it. Allow him to adduce evidence. Of course, what is the standard of proof that is required from the accused will come later. But why the necessity of casting or transferring the burden or shifting the burden on the accused is that every fact cannot be expected to be proved by the prosecution. Or for example, the nature of the offense. For example, you see under the NDPS Act, the possession of the contraband substance itself is an offense. Now, under what circumstances he was found in possession? For example, the contraband substance is found in the dicky of the car driven by the accused, or the accused happens to be one of the passengers of the car. Now, the possession has been proved by the prosecution. Possession itself is an offense. Now, the accused may come of it with a defense saying that I had no conscious possession of this contraband substance. I was not knowing, I'm just a passenger. I was not knowing that the bag kept in the dicky contains the contraband substance or contained the contraband substance. Who has to prove it? Now the general law says, no, the essential burden is on the prosecution. But how the prosecution can prove it? Whereas the accused can be asked to show that under what circumstances he came to travel in that car, to whom that bag belonged, whether when he entered into boarded the car, whether their bag was there or not, from what point he started, and at that time, what were the things that were carried in there, what is the purpose for him for traveling in the sea, all these facts which throws the burden on the accused and lessens the burden on the prosecution, so that the purpose of the determining the truth could be arrived at. See, that is the purpose for which this concept of reverse burden has been devised. So these are the facts, we said, by their very nature can be proved by the accused. At the same time, these are the negative facts. That's also another reason why reverse burden is placed on the accused, contrary to the general principle or the basic principle of the criminal jurisprudence, because a prosecution cannot be asked to prove the negative, whereas positive, it is easy to be produced. A positive is known to the accused. Therefore, the accused who had knowledge of these facts would be in a better position to prove them, therefore, by a legal device called as presumption, the burden is shifted on the accused, and this is exactly what we call as the reverse burden. But you must remember that this burden passes to the accused only after the prosecution proves the basic or the foundational facts constituting the offense. In other words, the initial burden to prove the facts essential for establishing the charge are always on the prosecution. This primary burden or essential burden never shifts to the accused. The burden of proving the facts on the accused based on this reverse burden arise only when the prosecution establishes or proves the basic or the foundational facts. So this thing which must remember, it is only then the burden shifts from the accused to prove the facts which the law presumes against him. For example, if a married woman commits a suicide within 7 years, and there are allegations that she was subjected to ill treatment and cruelty in the matrimonial home, see, the court may presume, as per the law, as per the Indian Penal Code, the court may presume that the husband and relatives are abetted the suicide. But since there is a presumption which says that the court shall presume that they have abetted, now the prosecution is relieved of proving the basic facts or proving the facts which constitute an abetment. So in view of this presumption, which casts the burden on the accused, prosecution need not prove the facts constituting the abetment. It need not prove that there was aid, any of the accused aided or abetted, or there was instigation, or there was conspiracy driving the victim to commit suicide. See, it is relieved of all these facts, since because of the reverse burden that has been created under law. See, you may come across these instances of the reverse burden, and I think almost all the legal practitioners will be very familiar with Section 139 of the Negotiable Instruments Act. I think this is where a presumption is made in favor of the holder, which says that it shall be presumed, unless the contrary is proved, that the holder of a check received the check for the discharge in whole or in part of any debt or other legal liability. See, here, see how this concept of a reverse burden operates. When the essential ingredients constituting the offense under Section 138 is established by the complainant, it gives rise to a presumption which throws the burden on the accused by virtue of this presumption, which says that when the issuance of the check is proved, when the other compliance of the other formalities are proved, it shall be presumed that the check was issued by the accused for discharge of the debt or any other legal liability. Of course, we need not to delve deep into it. I think we can consider the other examples of reverse burden in the POCSO Act. In the POCSO Act, that is section 29 and 30 of the POCSO Act, where there is a presumption as to certain offenses. See how these presumptions and the doctrine of reverse burden operates. See, what is the presumption there? See, presumption as to certain offenses. Where a person is prosecuted for committing or abetting or attempting to commit any offense under section 3, 5, 7 and section 9 of the Act, special court shall presume that such person has committed or abetted or attempted to commit the offense, as the case may be, unless the contrary is proved. See, a presumption is where he has been prosecuted for sexual harassment or penetrative sexual assault or whatever it may be, then such person the court shall presume that such person has committed or abetted or attempted to commit the offense unless the contrary is proved. It is a rebuttable presumption. We'll come to it. There is another presumption, section 30, presumption of culpable mental state. I already gave you the example how this that is covered under this presumption. In any prosecution for any offense under this Act which requires a culpable mental state on the part of the accused, the special court shall presume the existence of such mental state, but it shall be a defense for the accused to prove the fact that he had no such mental state with respect to the act charged as an offense in that prosecution. I think the example what that I gave you, if you can see that how the reverse burden is done, because the fact of mental state is a question of fact. If you see that, what is the fact? It is defined under that. Fact is what a person can see, what you can hear, or the mental state. The motive is a mental state. So law says that because of this peculiarity of these offenses, or the nature of the victim of the offense, a child who cannot be asked, or the prosecution cannot gather evidence from the child with regard to the motive or the mental state of the accused, it says, then the court shall presume that the accused had that motive until it is contrary proved. So the burden shifts to the accused to prove that he did not have any such mental state. So that is the effect of the reverse burden and how it is operated. So the expression, unless the contrary is proved, makes it clear that the presumption raised is a rebuttable presumption. I think all of you may be knowing what is a rebuttable presumption and an absolute presumption. A rebuttable presumption can be raised only when the foundational facts constituting the offense are established by the prosecution. You must remember that in a criminal trial, the burden of proving everything essential to the establishment of the charge against the accused always rests on the prosecution, as every man is presumed to be innocent until the contrary is proved. But in a case where an offense is committed against the child, having regard to the very nature of the offense, where it is difficult for the prosecution to prove the facts and circumstances in which the offense has taken place, the Act has cast the burden on the accused to prove the facts within his knowledge, as it is easier for the innocent accused to produce evidence contrary to the case proved by the prosecution. So once the foundational or the essential facts constituting the offense under section 3, 5, 7 and 9 are proved by the accused, then because of this presumption, the burden shifts on the accused by what we call as a reverse burden, unless he discharges this burden. Of course, what is the standard of proof? The prosecution is required to prove the guilt of the accused, as you know, with the absolute standard of proof beyond reasonable doubt. But the standard of proof that is required on the accused to rebut the presumption is not that high as that of the prosecution. he has to prove the defense or the reverse burden cast on him with the standard of preponderance of probability. What is preponderance of probability? I said a fact is said to have been proved, like the as if is said to have been proved when, after considering the evidence, if the prudent man comes to the conclusion that it stands proved, I think that is it. Stands to the test of the preponderance of probability. If we adduce such kind of evidence, we say he has discharged his burden, he has rebutted the presumption, then that is a case to accept, the case for acquittal, to accept the defense or the burden, to accept the defense set up by the accused. Now, if we come to the NDPS Act, there are also certain presumptions. Section 35, presumption of culpable mental state. Just as what we said is in section 30 of the POXO Act, in any prosecution for an offense under this act, which requires a culpable mental state of the accused, the court shall presume the existence of such mental state, but it shall be a defense for the accused to prove the fact that he had no such mental state. I already gave you the example that he is found in possession of the psychotropic substance. He is found in possession of the ganja in the bag. When those basic essential fact is proved, it says that the court shall presume that he had the culpable mental state. So the burden shifts, reverses, it passes on to the accused. So that is the one of the presumption. And section 54, presumption from possession of illicit articles. In trials under this act, it may be presumed unless the contrary is proved. See, everywhere, unless the contrary is proved means it is a rebuttable presumption. So the accused will come to it, that whether it infringes upon the fundamental right or goes contrary to the basic principle, what we first said, is that we'll come to it. I'll just touch upon a decision. So it is a rebuttable presumption that says that that in trials under this act, it may be presumed unless the contrary is proved that the accused has committed an offense under this act in respect of any narcotic drug or any opium or poppy, any apparatus designed so and so, for the possession of which he fails to account satisfactorily. So these are the provisions under the Prevention of Act, Corruption Act, also section 20, you come across similar presumptions. See, whether such presumptions are they, and do they infringe upon the legal right of the accused, for the which states that every accused is deemed to be innocent until proved guilty. I think this issue came up for consideration of the Honorable Supreme Court in Noor Aga versus State of Punjab and another, 2008, 16 SEC 417. So the contention raised before the court was the provisions of section 35 and 54 of the act, being draconian in nature, imposing reverse burden on an accused, and thus being contrary to Article 14(2) of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, providing for an accused to be innocent until proved guilty, must be held to be ultra vires Article 14 and 21 of the Constitution of India. So the basic principle or the fundamental principle on which our criminal jurisprudence is based is also a part of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which also lays down that an accused to be treated or considered as innocent until proved guilty. So a challenge was laid that when you place the reverse burden on the accused, it impinges upon this fundamental principle and also the international covenant. So the Supreme Court went into the question whether the such a contention can be taken in view of the constitutional provisions and all other things. And after detailed discussion, it was held that in paragraph 54, relying upon the earlier decisions in Seema Silks, a legal provision does not become unconstitutional only it provides for a reverse burden. The question as regards burden of proof is procedural in nature. So just on that count, it is just because a burden is placed. And I told you, what is the rationale behind placing this burden on the accused? It is because of the difficulty faced by the prosecution. But at the same time, the society is trying to have justice. On that count, the accused cannot go scot-free. It is to balance these rights of the accused as well as the rights of the society, this concept has been devised. It is with that view, the doctrine of a reverse burden has been has found place in the statutes, especially in the special statutes. So this decision says the presumption raised against the trader is a rebuttable one, as in this case also it's a rebuttable one. Reverse burden, as also statutory presumptions, can be raised in several statutes. As for example, the Negotiable Instruments Act, Prevention of Corruption Act, TADA, etc. The presumption is raised only when certain foundational facts are established by the prosecution. This is what I already explained to you. So this reverse burden will pass to the accused only when the prosecution establishes the basic fact. It discharges the essential facts constituting the offense. The accused in such an event would be entitled to show that he had not violated the provisions of the act. Then it issues a word of caution. It says, provisions imposing reverse burden, however, must not only be required to be strictly complied with, but also may be subject to proof of some basic facts as envisaged under the statute in question. Therefore, what has been held is that these provisions of placing reverse burden, they are not unconstitutional. They stand the test of the prosecution. On the other hand, they simplify the proof in a court of law and advances the cause of justice. See, another aspect also, it was in paragraph 16, whether the burden on the accused is a legal burden or an evidential burden. So that issue also cropped up by the concern. So whether by this doctrine of or the concept of reverse burden, does it cast a legal burden or is it an evidentiary burden? So you must understand that though the wordings in the statutes are couched in a language as if some legal burden is cast on the accused, but in practice or in reality, they are only evidentiary burden or evidential burden. That is, the duty or the responsibility of the accused arises only after the charge is proved by the prosecution. Only after the facts or the basic the facts constituting the offense is proved, then only the accused steps in to disprove the facts of the proved by the prosecution. And here what has been said, whether the burden on the accused is a legal burden or an evidentiary burden would depend on the statute in question. The purport and object thereof must also be taken into consideration in determining the said question. It must pass the test of the doctrine of proportionality. The difficulties faced by the prosecution in certain cases may be held to be sufficient to arrive at an opinion that the burden on the accused is an evidentiary burden and not merely a legal burden. Here, if you see this in the narcotic, in the NDPS, this wordings that has been used is that in section 35. In section 35, subsection 2, I think those of you are having the act, I think it will help you. It says, so first I read to you presumption of culpable mental state, then explanation. In this section, culpable mental state includes intention, motive, knowledge of fact, and belief or reason to believe. Then for the purpose of this section, a fact is said to be proved only when the court believes it to exist beyond a reasonable doubt and not merely when its existence is established by a preponderance of probability. So here is some kind of a departure from what I explain to you from the general law. If you see under the Indian Evidence Act, a fact is said to be proved or a fact is proved in an ordinary way. And there's a Constitution Bench decision. There is AR 1963, page 200. M.G. Agarwal was the state of Maharashtra, which has laid down the law that a fact has to be proved in an ordinary way. That means with the standard of preponderance of probability. It is only the guilt of the accused that is required to be proved beyond reasonable doubt. See, there is a difference between proof of a fact and proof of the guilt. Now, for example, in a case of circumstantial evidence, there may be one or two or four facts that he was last seen and that there is some recovery is effected. See, while proving these facts, you can't apply the theory of absolute proof, proof beyond reasonable doubt. A fact cannot be proved. There is nothing called perfect or absolute proof. It is always a fact has to be proved with the standard of preponderance of probability only. But when you hold him guilty, when you come to the conclusion of the guilt of the accused, I think that conclusion must be beyond reasonable doubt. So that distinction you must keep in mind. But the law is a fact has to be produced, to be proved with the standard of preponderance of probabilities. But this subclause 2 of section 35 says in proving this mental state or in applying this presumption for the purpose of this, a fact is said to be proved when the court believes it to exist beyond reasonable doubt. See why this language is used? Because of the gravity of the offense, because of the seriousness of the offense. You may be knowing about another legal principle that higher the punishment, stricter the proof. See, this is an act where you can see that the stringent punishment is provided. Minimum sentence for every offense, there is a minimum sentence. That is the highest fine. And there is a presumption of possession for everything. Such stringent provisions are there. Then the law says when the initial burden that is placed on the accused must also satisfy this standard. That is the only meaning of it. Meaning of it is that even though the word says that you are, even the facts that you prove, that means the initial burden that is cast on you to prove the essential facts constitute an offense, that the accused is in possession of the contraband. These you have to discharge. And in that, in proving that fact also, there should not be any doubt. That is what is meant. Otherwise, the principle of law is very clear. In proving a fact, you cannot expect the absolute proof. But when having regard to the nature of the offense, the law says the process before calling upon the accused to discharge the reverse burden cast on him, the prosecution must prove the facts to the hilt, to the without any giving room for any reasonable doubt. So that is the meaning of it. So so therefore these provisions therefore make it very clear that there are, even under the earlier laws also, there are some provisions which cast, which placed the burden on the accused to prove the certain defenses or to prove the certain facts which are in his knowledge. The special acts having regard to the nature of the offenses or having regard to the proof that is required in an offense place this burden on the accused, what we call it, a reverse burden. But in proving this, in discharging this burden, the accused need not satisfy the, need not prove the facts beyond reasonable doubt. If he satisfies, leads evidence, he need not enter into the witness box. If he brings out the circumstances from the evidence of the prosecution to show that there is this burden placed on him is rebutted, he can always seek his acquittal. So this is the some of the principles which you should keep in mind, yes, in understanding the topic.